Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hen's Teeth and Horse's Toes, Further Reflections in Natural History by Stephen Jay Gould, narrated by Jonathan Sleep. Prologue. All the world loves a centennial. We can't resist the temptation to celebrate something clean and even in a ragged and uncertain world. I am gathering this third volume of collected essays in the midst of worldwide festivities for the third Darwinian centennial of our century. The first, in 1909, celebrated the 100th anniversary of Darwin's birth. The second, in 1959, the 100th year since publication of The Origin of Species. The third, in 1982, the 100th anniversary of his death. Darwin and evolutionary theory have been the focal point of all my writing in this series. My personal tribute to Darwin on his third centennial appears as Essay 9 in this volume. The sequence of centennials provides us with a fine epitome of evolutionary theory in our century, and with some insight into its present successes and tribulations. The organizers of the major 1909 shindig at Cambridge University had to cover up an embarrassing fact in preparing their hagiographical centennial volume. Although no thinking person doubted the fact of evolution by 1909, Darwin's own theory about its mechanism, natural selection, was not then at the height of its popularity. Indeed, 1909 marked the acme of confusion about how evolution happened in the midst of complete confidence that it had occurred. An embattled group of strict Darwinians, led by the aging A.R. Wallace in England and by A. Weismann in Germany, continued to hold that virtually all evolutionary change occurred by the cumulative power of natural selection building adaptation step by step from the random raw material of small-scale genetic variation. Lamarckism remained strong and provided an alternative to natural selection for the gradual building of adaptations. Creative organic response to perceived needs, and the transmission of these favorable responses to offspring through the inheritance of acquired characters. Mendelian inheritance, when properly elucidated, tipped the scales in Darwin's favor, but in 1909 it had, in the gropes of its youth, merely sown more confusion by adding yet a third mechanism to the swirling competition, production of a new species all at once by large and fortuitous mutations. By 1959, confusion had ceded to the opposite undesired state of complacency. Strict Darwinism had triumphed. The flowering of Mendelian genetics had finally laid Lamarckism to rest, since the workings of DNA provided no mechanism for an inheritance of acquired characters. Early fascination with large mutations had ceded to a recognition that copious and continuous small-scale variation also had a Mendelian base and provided a far better source for the raw material of evolutionary change than occasional and detrimental large mutations. But random small-scale variation produces no change by itself and requires a shaping force to preserve and enhance its favorable component. By 1959, nearly all evolutionary biologists had concluded that natural selection, after all, provided this creative mechanism of evolutionary change. At age 150, Darwin had triumphed. Yet, in the flush of victory, his latter-day disciples devised a version of his theory far narrower than anything Darwin himself would have allowed. The strict version went well beyond a simple assertion that natural selection is a predominant mechanism of evolutionary change, a proposition that I do not challenge. It emphasized a program for research that almost dissolved the organism into an amalgam of parts, each made as perfect as possible by the slow but relentless force of natural selection. This adaptationist program downplayed the ancient truth that organisms are integrated entities with pathways of development constrained by inheritance, not pieces of putty that selective forces of environment can push in any adaptive direction. The strict version, with its emphasis on copious, minute, random variation molded with excruciating but persistent slowness by natural selection, also implied that all events of large-scale evolution, macroevolution, were the gradual accumulated product of innumerable steps, each a minute adaptation to changing conditions within a local population. This extrapolationist theory denied any independence to macroevolution and interpreted all large-scale evolutionary events, origin of basic designs, long-term trends, patterns of extinction, and faunal turnover, as slowly accumulated microevolution, the study of small-scale changes within species. Finally, proponents of the strict version sought the source of all change in adaptive struggles among individual organisms, thus denying direct causal status to other levels in the rich hierarchy of nature, with its individuals both below the rung of organisms, genes, for example, and above, species, for example. The strict version, in short, emphasized gradual adaptive change produced by natural selection acting exclusively upon organisms. At the second centennial, some experts even declared that the immense complexity of evolution had yielded to final resolution. One leader remarked in a famous essay, "Differences of opinion on relatively minor points naturally persist, and many details remain to be filled in, but the essentials of the explanation of the history of life have probably now been achieved." Now, at the third centennial, Darwinian theory is in a vibrantly healthy state. Confidence in the basic mechanism of natural selection provides a theoretical underpinning and point of basic agreement that carries us beyond the pessimistic anarchy of 1909. But the constraints of an overzealous, strict version, so popular in 1959, are loosening. Exciting discoveries in molecular biology and in the study of embryological development have re-emphasized the integrity of organic form and hinted at modes of change different from the cumulative, gradual alteration emphasized by strict Darwinians. Direct study of fossil sequences has also challenged gradualistic biases, the punctuated equilibrium pattern of long-term stasis within species and geologically rapid origin of new species, and asserted the idea of explanatory hierarchy in identifying species as discrete and active evolutionary agents, just as molecular biology has extended hierarchy in the other direction by discovering evolutionary processes at genetic levels that are invisible to organisms. However, and unironically, the early 1980s have also witnessed an utterly different and perverse debate about evolution, often conflated in the public mind with these legitimate and exciting arguments about evolutionary mechanisms. I refer, of course, to the political resurgence of the pseudoscience known to its supporters as scientific creationism, strict Genesis literalism masquerading as science in a cynical attempt to bypass the First Amendment and win legislatively mandated inclusion of particular and minority religious views into public school curricula. As in 1909, no scientist or thinking person doubts the basic fact that life evolves. Intense debates about how evolution occurs display science at its most exciting, but provide no solace, only phony ammunition by willful distortion to strict fundamentalists. This peculiar juxtaposition of utterly different debates ostensibly about the same subject reminds me either of Wagner's two operas about song contests, Tannhäuser and Die Meistersinger, one sublime, the other comic, or of Spielberg's two films about oddities in suburbia for a 1982 summer, E.T. and Poltergeist, one joyful, the other sinister. But life is a continual conflation of sacred and profane, and who would have it any other way? The present collection of essays about evolution was born amidst these tensions. It treats both the purely political and non-intellectual controversy stirred up by modern creationists, Section 5, and the fascinating debates now occurring within evolutionary theory. I discuss, for example, the role of alterations in embryonic development as a possible mechanism for rapid evolutionary transformations, Section 3. Chance as a source of evolutionary change, not merely raw material, Essay 26. Evolution at hierarchical levels, both above and below the traditional Darwinian focus on organisms, Essay 13, and constraints of development and inheritance as arguments for the integrity of organisms and against an overly atomistic and deterministic view of adaptation, Section 3, but also as a major theme in Essays 3, 10, and 29. An ultimately more important tension, one that makes evolution such an exciting subject both for scientists and for all of us, contrasts these lively controversies that divide us with the enormous uniting power and extension of evolutionary theory itself. As I have explored the arguments, so too have I written about a view of life that has, since Darwin's day, transformed our concept of ourselves and our world. Big questions about the history of our Earth and its life provide a way to explore the thought of exemplary past scientists and to understand the process of science itself when done best, Section 2. If listeners emerge from this section with the message that science traffics in answerable questions, not in every fascinating reverie of the human mind, then they will also understand why modern creationism is not science. The seepage of evolutionary questions into ostensibly distant political debates, Section 5, displays both the pervasive scope of this view of life and also the inextricable union of scientific and social issues. The broader and distinct view that emerges from evolutionary theory could enlarge our concept of science and of explanation in general by emphasizing historical contingency and quirky change, but sensible in retrospect, against the predictable and regular world preached by the stereotype of so-called hard science. I explore this issue throughout, but primarily in Essay 4, the one piece that should probably be listened to twice if you deem any essay worthy of such attention. These issues are all abstract, but my vehicle for raising them remains the peculiar and mysterious particulars of nature. I've never been able to raise much personal enthusiasm for disembodied theory. Thus, when I wish to explore the explanatory power of evolutionary theory, Section 1, I write about apparent oddities resolved by Darwin's view: dwarf male anglerfishes parasitically united with females, wasps that paralyze insects to provide a living feast for their larvae, young birds that kill their siblings by simply pushing them outside a ring of guano serving as a nest, and male mites that cycle through their lives in a fraction of the time allotted to females. Other essays treat generalities through the agency of particular mysteries. Why are the genitalia of female spotted hyenas dead ringers for the male penis and scrotum? Why do no large animals move on wheels? How can hens be induced to form teeth when no birds have produced them for more than 50 million years? How can some flies form legs in their mouths? I even discuss an ouchless mosquito so afflicted. Why did the demise of dinosaurs coincide with the extinction of at least 25% of marine invertebrate families? Are zebras white on black or black on white? And what general rule unites their varied patterns of striping? I even think that a generality lies behind my piece on shrinking Hershey bars, but I won't push it. Pure humor, or attempts thereat, has its place as well. Darwin, at his third centennial, would be satisfied indeed with the vigor of his child, now grown so large and strong. He would also welcome the legitimate and far-reaching debates that surround his theory, for absence of dogmatism is the truest mark of a great scientist. At the first centennial of 1909, William Bateson, perhaps the least Darwinian of all participants, paid the finest of all tributes by writing of Darwin, "We shall honor most in him, not the rounded merit of finite accomplishment, but the creative power by which he inaugurated a line of discovery endless in variety and extension." 1. Sensible Oddities. 1. Big Fish, Little Fish. Alfred Lord Tennyson, never known for egalitarian perspectives, had this to say about the relative merit of the sexes: "Woman is the lesser man, and all thy passions, matched with mine, are as moonlight unto sunlight, and as water unto wine." The couplet may not represent Tennyson's considered view, since the protagonist of Locksley Hall had lost his love to another and speaks these words during a grand poetic fit of sour grapes. Still, the literal reading, that women are smaller than men, would be accepted by most of us as a general fact of nature, not as a sexist trap. And most of us would therefore be wrong. Human males are, of course, generally larger than human females, and most familiar mammals follow the same pattern. Yet females are larger than males in a majority of animal species, and probably a large majority at that. For starters, most animal species are insects, and female insects usually exceed their males in size. Why are males generally smaller? One amusing suggestion was proposed in all seriousness just 100 years ago, as I discovered in the 50 and 100 years ago column in Scientific American for January 1982. A certain M.G. Delaunay argued that human races might be ranked by the relative social position of females. Inferior races suffered under female supremacy. Males dominated in superior races, while equality of sexes marked races of middle mark. As collateral support for his peculiar thesis, Delaunay argued that females are larger than males in lower animals and smaller in higher creatures. Thus, the greater number of species with larger females posed no threat to a general notion of male superiority. After all, many serve and few rule. Delaunay's argument is almost too precious to disturb with refutation, but it's probably worth mentioning that the paradigm case of a higher group with larger males, the mammals, is shakier than most people think. Males are larger in a majority of mammalian species, of course, but Rawls found a surprising number of species with larger females, spread widely throughout the range of mammalian diversity. 12 of 20 orders and 20 of 122 families contain species with larger females. In some important groups, larger females are the rule. Rabbits and hares, a family of bats, three families of baleen whales, a major group of seals, and two tribes of antelopes. Rawls further reminds us that since blue whales are the largest animals that have ever lived, and since females surpass males in baleen whales, the largest individual animal of all time is undoubtedly a female. The biggest reliably measured whale was 93.5 feet long and a female. The sporadic distribution of larger females within the taxonomic range of mammals illustrates the most important general conclusion we can reach about the relative size of sexes. The observed pattern does not suggest any general or overarching trend associating predominance of either sex with anatomical complexity, geological age, or supposed evolutionary stage. Rather, the relative size of sexes seems to reflect an evolved strategy for each particular circumstance, an affirmation of Darwin's vision that evolution is primarily the story of adaptation to local environments. In this perspective, we must anticipate the usual pattern of larger females. Females, as producers of eggs, are usually more active than males in brooding their young. Such male tenders as seahorses and various mouth-brooding fishes must receive eggs directly from a female or actively pick up eggs after a female discharges them. Even in species that furnish no parental care, eggs must be provided with nutriment, while sperm is little more than naked DNA with a delivery system. Larger eggs require more room and a bigger body to produce them. If females provide the essential nutriment for embryonic or larval growth, we must ask why males exist at all. Why bother with sex if one parent can supply the essential provisioning? The answer to this old dilemma seems to lie in the nature of Darwin's world. If natural selection propels evolution by preserving favored variants from a spectrum randomly distributed about an average value, then an absence of variation derails the process, for natural selection makes nothing directly and can only choose among alternatives presented. If all offspring were the Xeroxed copies of a single parent, they would present no genetic variation, except for rare new mutations, and selection could not operate effectively. Sex generates an enormous array of variation by mixing the genetic material of two creatures in each offspring. If only for this reason, we shall have males to kick around for some time. But if the biological function of males does not extend beyond the contribution of some essentially naked DNA, why bother to put so much effort into making them? Why should they, in most cases, be almost as big as females, endowed with complex organs and quite capable of an independent life? Why should industrious bees continue to make the large and largely useless male creatures appropriately known as drones? These questions would be difficult to answer if evolution worked for the good of species or larger groups. But Darwin's theory of natural selection holds that evolution is fundamentally a struggle among individual organisms to pass more of their genes into future generations. Since males are essential, they become evolutionary agents in their own right. They are not designed for the benefit of their species. As independent agents, they join the struggle in their own ways, and these ways sometimes favor a larger size. In many groups, males fight literally for access to females, and heavyweights often have an edge. In more complex creatures, social life may emerge and become ever more elaborate. Such complexity may require the presence and active involvement of more than one parent in the rearing of offspring, and males gain a biological role transcending mere stud service. But what of ecological situations that neither favor battle nor require parental care? After all, Tennyson's most famous biological line, his description of life's ecology as nature, red in tooth and claw, does not apply in all or most cases. Darwin's struggle for existence is a metaphor and need not imply active combat. The struggle for genetic representation in the next generation can be pursued in a variety of ways. One common strategy mimics the motto of rigged elections: vote early and vote often, but substitute fornicate for vote. Males who follow this tactic have no evolutionary rationale for large size and complexity beyond what they need to locate a female as quickly as possible and to stick around. In such cases, we might expect to find males in their minimal state, a status that might have become quite general if evolution worked for the good of species, a small device dedicated to the delivery of sperm. Nature, ever obliging, has provided us with some examples of what, but for the grace of natural selection, might have been my fate. Consider a species so thinly spread over such a broad area that males will rarely meet at the sight of a female. Suppose also that females, as adults, move very little, if at all. They may be attached to the substrate, barnacles, for example. They may live parasitically within another creature, or they may feed by waiting and luring rather than by pursuit. And suppose, finally, that the surrounding medium can easily move small creatures about, as in the sea with its currents and high density. Since males have little impetus for literal battle, since they must find a stationary female, and since the medium in which they live can provide or substantially aid their transport, why be large? Why not find a female fast when still quite small and young and then hang on as a simple source of sperm? Why work and feed and grow large and complex? Why not exploit the feeding female? All her offspring will still be 50% you. Indeed, this strategy is quite common, although little appreciated by sentient mammals of different status. Among marine invertebrates that either live at great depth, where food is scarce and populations very thinly spread, or place themselves in widely dispersed spots that are hard to locate, as in many parasites. Here we often encounter that ultimate in the expression of nature's more common tendency, females larger than males. The males become dwarfs, often less than one-tenth the length of females, and evolve a body suited primarily for finding females, a sperm delivery system of sorts. A species of enterozoos, for example, a molluscan parasite that lives inside the gut of sea cucumbers, echinoderms related to sea urchins and starfishes, was originally described as a hermaphrodite, with both male and female organs. But Jay Lutzen of the University of Copenhagen recently discovered that the male organ is actually the degenerated product of a separate dwarf male organism that found the parasitic female and attached permanently to her. The female enterozoos fastens herself to the sea cucumber's esophagus by a small ciliated tube. The dwarf male finds the tube, enters the female's body, attaches to it in a particular place, and then loses virtually all its organs, except, of course, for the testes. After a male enters, the female breaks its tubular connection with the sea cucumber's esophagus, thereby obliterating the pathway of entrance for any future males. A strict Darwinian, I am not one, would predict that the male has evolved some device to break or cause the female to break this tubular connection, thereby excluding all subsequent males and assuring its own paternity for all the female's offspring. But no evidence yet exists for or against this hypothesis. As long as such an uncomfortable phenomenon resides with unfamiliar and lowly invertebrates, male supremacists who seek pseudo-support from nature may not be greatly disturbed. But I am delighted to tell a similar story about one group of eminently suited vertebrates, deep-sea anglerfishes of the Ceratioidei, a large group with 11 families and nearly 100 species. Ceratioid anglerfishes have all the prerequisites for evolving dwarf males as sperm delivery systems. They live at depth in the open ocean, mostly from 3,000 to 10,000 feet below the surface, where food is scarce and population sparse. Females have detached the first dorsal fin ray and move it forward over their capacious mouth. They dangle a lure at the tip of this spine and literally fish with it. They jiggle and wave the lure while floating, otherwise immobile, in the midst of the sea. The related shallower water and bottom-dwelling anglerfishes often evolve elaborate mimetic structures for their lures, bits of tissue that resemble worms or even a decoy fish. Ceratioids live well below the depth that light can penetrate seawater. Their world is one of total ambient darkness, and they must therefore provide the light of attraction themselves. Their lures glow with a luminescence supplied by light glands, a death trap for prey, and perhaps a beacon for dwarf males. In 1922, B. Samundsson, an Icelandic fisheries biologist, dredged a female Ceratius holboli, 26.16 inches in length. To his surprise, he found two small anglerfish, only 2.03 and 2.1 inches long, attached to the female's skin. He assumed, naturally, that they were juveniles, but he was puzzled by their degenerate form. At first sight, he wrote, I thought these young ones were pieces of skin torn off and loose. Another oddity puzzled him even more. These small fish were so firmly attached that their lips had grown together about a wad of female tissue projecting well into their mouths and down their throats. Samundsson could find no other language for his description but an obvious inappropriate mammalian analogy. The lips are grown together and are attached to a soft papilla or teat protruding, so far as I can see, from the belly of the mother. 3 years later, the great British ichthyologist C. Tate Regan, then keeper of fishes and later boss of the British Museum Natural History, solved Samundsson's dilemma. The young ones were not juveniles, but permanently attached, sexually mature dwarf males. As Regan studied the details of attachment between male and female, he discovered the astounding fact that has ever since been celebrated as one of the greatest oddities in natural history. At the junction of the male and the female fish, there is a complete blending. Their vascular systems are continuous. In other words, the male has ceased to function as an independent organism. It no longer feeds, for its mouth is fused with the female's outer skin. The vascular systems of male and female have united, and the tiny male is entirely dependent upon the female's blood for nutrition. Of a second species with similar habits, Regan writes, it is impossible to say where one fish begins and the other ends. The male has become a sexual appendage of the female, a kind of incorporated penis. Both popular and technical literature often refer to the fused male as a parasite, but I demur. Parasites live at the expense of their host. Fused males depend upon females for nutrition, but they supply in return that most precious of biological gifts, access to the next generation and a chance for evolutionary continuity. The extent of male submergence has been exaggerated in most popular accounts. Although attached males surrender their vascular independence and lose or reduce a set of organs no longer needed, eyes, for example, they remain more than a simple penis. Their own hearts must still pump the blood now supplied by females, and they continue to breathe with their gills and remove wastes with their kidneys. Of one firmly attached male, Regan writes, the male fish, although to a great extent merely an appendage of the female and entirely dependent on her for nutrition, yet retains a certain autonomy. He is probably capable, by movements of the tail and fins, of changing his position to some extent. He breathes, he may have functional kidneys, and he removes from the blood certain products of his own metabolism and keeps them as pigment. But so perfect and complete is the union of husband and wife that one may almost be sure that their genital glands ripen simultaneously, and it is perhaps not too fanciful to think that the female may possibly be able to control the seminal discharge of the male and to ensure that it takes place at the right time for the fertilization of her eggs. Nonetheless, however autonomous, The males have not honed themselves to Darwinian optimality, where they have evolved no mechanism for excluding other males from subsequent attachment. Several males are often embedded into a single female. While criticizing the exaggeration of some popular accounts, allow me a tangential excursion to express a pet peeve. I relied upon primary technical literature for all my descriptions, but I began by reading several popular renditions. All versions written for non-scientists speak of fused males as the curious tale of the anglerfish, just as we so often hear about the monkey swinging through trees or the worm burrowing through soil. But if nature teaches any lesson, it loudly proclaims life's diversity. There ain't no such abstraction as the clam, the fly, or the anglerfish. Ceratioid anglerfishes come in nearly 100 species, and each has its own peculiarity. Fused males have not evolved in all species. In some, males attach temporarily, presumably at times of spawning, but never fuse. In others, some males fuse and others become sexually mature while retaining their bodily independence. In still others, fusion is obligatory. In one species of obligate fusers, no sexually mature female has ever been found without an attached male, and the stimulus provided by male hormones may be a prerequisite for maturation. These obligate fusers have become the paradigm for popular descriptions of the anglerfish, but they do not represent the majority of ceratioid species. I grouse because these meaningless abstractions convey seriously false impressions about nature. They greatly exaggerate nature's discontinuities by focusing on extreme forms as false paradigms for an entire group, and rarely mentioning the structurally intermediate species that often live happily and abundantly. If all fishes either had totally independent or completely fused males, then how could we even imagine an evolutionary transition to the peculiar sexual system of the anglerfish? But the abundance of structurally intermediate stages, temporary attachment or fusion of some males only, conveys an evolutionary message. These modern structural intermediates are not, of course, actual ancestors of fully fused species, but they do sketch an evolutionary pathway, just as Darwin studied the simple eyes of worms and scallops to learn how a structure so complex and apparently perfect as the vertebrate eye might evolve through a chain of intermediate forms. In any case, bursting diversity is nature's watchword. It should never be submerged by careless abstraction. Ceratioid males embark upon their peculiar course early in life. As larvae, they feed normally and live independently. After a period of rapid change, or metamorphosis, males in species destined for fusion do not develop their alimentary canals any further, and never feed again. Their ordinary teeth disappear, and they retain and exaggerate only a few fused teeth at the tips of their mouth, useless in feeding, but well adapted for piercing and holding tight to a female. They become sleek and more streamlined, with a pointed head, compressed body, and strong propulsive tail fin. In short, a sort of sexual torpedo. But how do they find females, those tiny dots of connubial matter in the midst of an endless ocean? Most species must use olfactory cues, a system often exquisitely developed in fishes, as in homing salmon that smell out their natal stream. These ceratioid males develop gigantic nostrils after metamorphosis. Relative to body size, some ceratioids have larger nasal organs than any other vertebrate. Another family of ceratioids fails to develop large nostrils, but these males have enormously enlarged eyes, and they must search for the ghostly light of fishing females. Each species has a different pattern of illumination, and males probably recognize their proper females. The system is not entirely failsafe, as ichthyologist Ted Peach recently found a male of one species attached to a female of a different species, a fatal mistake in evolutionary terms, although the two fish had not fused and might later have separated had not zealous science found and preserved them in flagrante delicto. As I sit here wiggling my toes and flexing my fingers in glorious independence, and with a full 1-inch advantage over my wife, I am tempted, but must resist, to apply the standards of my own cherished independence and to pity the poor fused male. It may not be much of a life in our terms, but it keeps several species of anglerfishes going in a strange and difficult environment. And who can judge anyway? In some ultimate Freudian sense, what male could resist the fantasy of life as a penis with a heart, deeply and permanently embedded within a caring and providing female? These anglerfishes represent, in any case, only the extreme expression of nature's more common pattern: smaller males pursuing an evolutionary role as sources of sperm. Do they not, therefore, teach us a generality by their very exaggeration of it? We human males are the oddballs. I therefore take my leave of fused anglerfishes with a certain sense of awe. Have they not discovered and irrevocably established for themselves what, according to Shakespeare, every wise man's son doth know: journeys end in lovers' meeting? 2. Non-moral nature. When the Right Honorable and Reverend Francis Henry, Earl of Bridgewater, died in February 1829, he left £8,000 to support a series of books on the power, wisdom, and goodness of God as manifested in the creation. William Buckland, England's first official academic geologist and later Dean of Westminster, was invited to compose one of the 9 Bridgewater treatises. In it, he discussed the most pressing problems of natural theology. If God is benevolent and the creation displays His power, wisdom, and goodness, then why are we surrounded with pain, suffering, and apparently senseless cruelty in the animal world? Buckland considered the depredation of carnivorous races as the primary challenge to an idealized world where the lion might dwell with the lamb. He resolved the issue to his satisfaction by arguing that carnivores actually increase the aggregate of animal enjoyment and diminish that of pain. Death, after all, is swift and relatively painless. Victims are spared the ravages of decrepitude and senility, and populations do not outrun their food supply to the greater sorrow of all. God knew what He was doing when He made lions. Buckland continued in hardly concealed rapture, "The appointment of death by the agency of carnivora as the ordinary termination of animal existence appears, therefore, in its main results to be a dispensation of benevolence. It deducts much from the aggregate amount of the pain of universal death. It abridges and almost annihilates, throughout the brute creation, the misery of disease and accidental injuries and lingering decay, and imposes such salutary restraint upon excessive increase of numbers that the supply of food maintains perpetually a due ratio to the demand. The result is that the surface of the land and depths of the waters are ever crowded with myriads of animated beings, the pleasures of whose life are coextensive with its duration, and which throughout the little day of existence that is allotted to them fulfill with joy the functions for which they were created." We may find a certain amusing charm in Buckland's vision today, but such arguments did begin to address the problem of evil for many of Buckland's contemporaries. How could a benevolent God create such a world of carnage and bloodshed? Yet this argument could not abolish the problem of evil entirely, for nature includes many phenomena far more horrible in our eyes than simple predation. I suspect that nothing evokes greater disgust in most of us than slow destruction of a host by an internal parasite, gradual ingestion bit by bit from the inside. In no other way can I explain why Alien, an uninspired grade C formula horror film, should have won such a following. That single scene of Mr. Alien popping forth as a baby parasite from the body of a human host was both sickening and stunning. Our 19th century forebears maintained similar feelings. The greatest challenge to their concept of a benevolent deity was not simple predation, but slow death by parasitic ingestion. The classic case, treated at length by all great naturalists, invoked the so-called ichneumon fly. Buckland had sidestepped the major issue. The ichneumon fly, which provoked such concern among natural theologians, was actually a composite creature representing the habits of an enormous tribe. The ichneumonoidea are a group of wasps, not flies, that include more species than all the vertebrates combined. Wasps, with ants and bees, constitute the order Hymenoptera. Flies with their two wings, wasps have four, form the order Diptera. In addition, many non-ichneumonid wasps of similar habits were often cited for the same grisly details. Thus, the famous story did not merely implicate a single aberrant species, perhaps a perverse leakage from Satan's realm, but hundreds of thousands, a large chunk of what could only be God's creation. The ichneumons, like most wasps, generally live freely as adults but pass their larval life as parasites feeding on the bodies of other animals, almost invariably members of their own phylum, the arthropoda. The most common victims are caterpillars, butterfly and moth larvae, but some ichneumons prefer aphids and others attack spiders. Most hosts are parasitized as larvae, but some adults are attacked, and many tiny ichneumons inject their brood directly into the egg of their host. The free-flying females locate an appropriate host and then convert it to a food factory for their own young. Parasitologists speak of ectoparasitism when the uninvited guest lives on the surface of its host, and endoparasitism when the parasite dwells within. Among endoparasitic ichneumons, adult females pierce the host with their ovipositor and deposit eggs within. The ovipositor, a thin tube extending backward from the wasp's rear end, may be many times as long as the body itself. Usually, the host is not otherwise inconvenienced for the moment, at least until the eggs hatch and the ichneumon larvae begin their grim work of interior excavation. Among ectoparasites, however, many females lay their eggs directly upon the host's body. Since an active host would easily dislodge the egg, the ichneumon mother often simultaneously injects a toxin that paralyzes the caterpillar or other victim. The paralysis may be permanent, and the caterpillar lies, alive but immobile, with the agent of its future destruction secure on its belly. The egg hatches, the helpless caterpillar twitches, the wasp larva pierces and begins its grisly feast. Since a dead and decaying caterpillar will do the wasp larva no good, it eats in a pattern that cannot help but recall, in our inappropriate, anthropocentric interpretation, the ancient English penalty for treason, drawing and quartering with its explicit object of extracting as much torment as possible by keeping the victim alive and sentient. As the king's executioner drew out and burned his client's entrails, so does the ichneumon larva eat fat bodies and digestive organs first, keeping the caterpillar alive by preserving intact the essential heart and central nervous system. Finally, the larva completes its work and kills its victim, leaving behind the caterpillar's empty shell. Is it any wonder that ichneumons, not snakes or lions, stood as the paramount challenge to God's benevolence during the heyday of natural theology? As I read through the 19th and 20th century literature on ichneumons, nothing amused me more than the tension between an intellectual knowledge that wasps should not be described in human terms and a literary or emotional inability to avoid the familiar categories of epic and narrative, pain and destruction, victim and vanquisher. We seem to be caught in the mythic structures of our own cultural sagas, quite unable, even in our basic descriptions, to use any other language than the metaphors of battle and conquest. We cannot render this corner of natural history as anything but story, combining the themes of grim horror and fascination, and usually ending not so much with pity for the caterpillar as with admiration for the efficiency of the ichneumon. I detect two basic themes in most epic descriptions, the struggles of prey and the ruthless efficiency of parasites. Although we acknowledge that we may be witnessing little more than automatic instinct or physiological reaction, still we describe the defenses of host as though they represented conscious struggles. Thus, aphids kick, and caterpillars may wriggle violently as wasps attempt to insert their ovipositors. The pupa of the tortoiseshell butterfly, usually considered an inert creature silently awaiting its conversion from duckling to swan, may contort its abdominal region so sharply that attacking wasps are thrown into the air. The caterpillars of Hypalia, when attacked by the wasp Apanthales mercurialis, drop suddenly from their leaves and suspend themselves in air by a silken thread. But the wasp may run down the thread and insert its eggs nonetheless. Some hosts can encapsulate the injected egg with blood cells that aggregate and harden, thus suffocating the parasite. J. H. Fabre, the great 19th century French entomologist, who remains to this day the preeminent literate natural historian of insects, made a special study of parasitic wasps and wrote with an unabashed anthropocentrism about the struggles of paralyzed victims. See his books Insect Life and The Wonders of Instinct. He describes some imperfectly paralyzed caterpillars that struggle so violently every time a parasite approaches that the wasp larvae must feed with unusual caution. They attach themselves to a silken strand from the roof of their burrow and descend upon a safe and exposed part of the caterpillar. The grub is at dinner, head downwards. It is digging into the limp belly of one of the caterpillars. At the least sign of danger in the heap of caterpillars, the larva retreats and climbs back to the ceiling where the swarming rabble cannot reach it. When peace is restored, it slides down its silken cord and returns to table with its head over the viands and its rear upturned and ready to withdraw in case of need. In another chapter, he describes the fate of a paralyzed cricket. One may see the cricket, bitten to the quick, vainly move its antennae and abdominal styles, open and close its empty jaws, and even move a foot. But the larva is safe and searches its vitals with impunity. What an awful nightmare for the paralyzed cricket! Fabre even learned to feed paralyzed victims by placing a syrup of sugar and water on their mouthparts, thus showing that they remained alive, sentient, and by implication, grateful for any palliation of their inevitable fate. If Jesus, immobile and thirsting on the cross, received only vinegar from his tormentors, Fabre at least could make an ending bittersweet. The second theme, ruthless efficiency of the parasites, leads to the opposite conclusion, grudging admiration for the victors. We learn of their skill in capturing dangerous hosts, often many times larger than themselves. Caterpillars may be easy game, but Semochorid wasps prefer spiders. They must insert their ovipositors in a safe and precise spot. Some leave a paralyzed spider in its burrow. Planiceps hirsutus, for example, parasitizes a California trapdoor spider. It searches for spider tubes on sand dunes, then digs into nearby sand to disturb the spider's home and drive it out. When the spider emerges, the wasp attacks, paralyzes its victim, drags it back into its own tube, shuts and fastens the trapdoor, and deposits a single egg upon the spider's abdomen. Other Semochorids will drag a heavy spider back to a previously prepared cluster of clay or mud cells. Some amputate a spider's legs to make the passage easier. Others fly back over water, skimming a buoyant spider along the surface. Some wasps must battle with other parasites over a host's body. Rhizella corvipes can detect the larvae of wood wasps deep within alderwood and drill down to a potential victim with its sharply ridged ovipositor. Pseudorhiza alpestris, a related parasite, cannot drill directly into wood since its slender ovipositor bears only rudimentary cutting ridges. It locates the holes made by Rhizella, inserts its ovipositor, and lays an egg on the host, already conveniently paralyzed by Rhizella, right next to the egg deposited by its relative. The two eggs hatch at about the same time, but the larva of Pseudorhiza has a bigger head bearing much larger mandibles. Pseudorhiza seizes the smaller Rhizella larva, destroys it, and proceeds to feast upon a banquet already well prepared. Other praises for the efficiency of mothers invoke the themes of early, quick, and often. Many ichneumons don't even wait for their host to develop into larvae, but parasitize the egg directly. Larval wasps may then either drain the egg itself or enter the developing host larva. Others simply move fast. Apanteles militaris can deposit up to 72 eggs in a single second. Still, others are doggedly persistent. Aphidius gomezi females produce up to 1,500 eggs and can parasitize as many as 600 aphids in a single working day. In a bizarre twist upon often, some wasps indulge in polyembryony, a kind of iterated supertwining. A single egg divides into cells that aggregate into as many as 500 individuals. Since some polyembryonic wasps parasitize caterpillars much larger than themselves and may lay up to 6 eggs in each, as many as 3,000 larvae may develop within and feed upon a single host. These wasps are endoparasites and do not paralyze their victims. The caterpillars writhe back and forth, not, one suspects, from pain, but merely in response to the commotion induced by thousands of wasp larvae feeding within. Maternal efficiency is often matched by larval aptitude. I have already mentioned the pattern of eating less essential parts first, thus keeping the host alive and fresh to its final and merciful dispatch. After the larva digests every edible morsel of its victim, if only to prevent later fouling of its abode by decaying tissue, it may still use the outer shell of its host. One aphid parasite cuts a hole in the bottom of its victim's shell, glues the skeleton to a leaf by sticky secretions from its salivary gland, and then spins a cocoon to pupate within the aphid's shell. In using inappropriate anthropocentric language for this romp through the natural history of ichneumons, I have tried to emphasize just why these wasps became a preeminent challenge to natural theology, the antiquated doctrine that attempted to infer God's essence from the products of His creation. I've used 20th century examples for the most part, but all themes were known and stressed by the great 19th century natural theologians. How then did they square the habits of these wasps with the goodness of God? How did they extract themselves from this dilemma of their own making? The strategies were as varied as the practitioners. They shared only the theme of special pleading for an a priori doctrine. Our naturalists knew that God's benevolence was lurking somewhere behind all these tales of apparent horror. Charles Lyell, for example, in the first edition of his epical Principles of Geology, 1830-1833, decided that caterpillars posed such a threat to vegetation that any natural checks upon them could only reflect well upon a creating deity, for caterpillars would destroy human agriculture. Did not Providence put causes in operation to keep them in due bounds? The Reverend William Kirby, rector of Barham and Britain's foremost entomologist, chose to ignore the plight of caterpillars and focused instead upon the virtue of mother love displayed by wasps in provisioning their young with such care. The great object of the female is to discover a proper nidus for her eggs. In search of this, she is in constant motion. Is the caterpillar of a butterfly or moth the appropriate food for her young? You see her alight upon the plants where they are most usually to be met with, run quickly over them, carefully examining each leaf, and having found the unfortunate object of her search, insert her sting into its flesh, and there deposit an egg. The active ichneumon braves every danger and does not desist until her courage and address have ensured sustenance for one of her future progeny. Kirby found this solicitude all the more remarkable because the female wasp will never see her child and enjoy the pleasures of parenthood. Yet love compels her to danger nonetheless. A very large proportion of them are doomed to die before their young come into existence, but in these the passion is not extinguished. When you witness the solicitude with which they provide for the security and sustenance of their future young, you can scarcely deny to them love for a progeny they are never destined to behold. Kirby also put in a good word for the marauding larvae, praising them for their forbearance in eating selectively to keep their caterpillar alive. Would we all husband our resources with such care? In this strange and apparent cruel operation, one circumstance is truly remarkable. The larva of the ichneumon, though every day, perhaps for months, it gnaws the inside of the caterpillar, and though at last it has devoured almost every part of it except the skin and intestines, carefully all this time it avoids injuring the vital organs, as if aware that its own existence depends on that of the insect upon which it preys. What would be the impression which a similar instance amongst the race of quadrupeds would make upon us? If, for example, an animal should be found to feed upon the inside of a dog, devouring only those parts not essential to life, while it cautiously left uninjured the heart, arteries, lungs, and intestines, should we not regard such an instance as a perfect prodigy, as an example of instinctive forbearance almost miraculous? The last three quotes come from the 1856 and last pre-Darwinian edition of Kirby and Spence's Introduction to Entomology. This tradition of attempting to read moral meaning from nature did not cease with the triumph of evolutionary theory in 1859, for evolution could be read as God's chosen method of peopling our planet, and ethical messages might still populate nature. Thus, St. George Mivart, one of Darwin's most effective evolutionary critics and a devout Catholic, argued that many amiable and excellent people had been misled by the apparent suffering of animals for two reasons. First, whatever the pain, physical suffering and moral evil are simply incommensurable. Since beasts are not moral agents, their feelings cannot bear any ethical message. But secondly, lest our visceral sensitivities still be aroused, Mivart assures us that animals must feel little, if any, pain. Using a favorite racist argument of the time, that primitive people suffer far less than advanced and cultured folk, Mivart extrapolated further down the ladder of life into a realm of very limited pain indeed. Physical suffering, he argued, depends greatly upon the mental condition of the sufferer. Only during consciousness does it exist, and only in the most highly organized men does it reach its acme. The author has been assured that lower races of men appear less keenly sensitive to physical suffering than do more cultivated and refined human beings. Thus, only in man can there really be any intense degree of suffering, because only in him is there that intellectual recollection of past moments and that anticipation of future ones which constitute in great part the bitterness of suffering. The momentary pang, the present pain which beasts endure, though real enough, is yet, doubtless, not to be compared as to its intensity with the suffering which is produced in man through his high prerogative of self-consciousness. From Genesis of Species, 1871. It took Darwin himself to derail this ancient tradition, and he proceeded in the gentle way so characteristic of his radical intellectual approach to nearly everything. The ichneumons also troubled Darwin greatly, and he wrote of them to Asa Gray in 1860. I own that I cannot see as plainly as others do, and as I should wish to do, evidence of design and beneficence on all sides of us. There seems to me too much misery in the world. I cannot persuade myself that a beneficent and omnipotent God would have designedly created the ichneumonidae with the express intention of their feeding within the living bodies of caterpillars, or that a cat should play with mice. Indeed, he had written with more passion to Joseph Hooker in 1856, what a book a devil's chaplain might write on the clumsy, wasteful, blundering, low, and horribly cruel works of nature. This honest admission, that nature is often, by our standards, cruel, and that all previous attempts to find a lurking goodness behind everything represent just so much special pleading, can lead in two directions. One might retain the principle that nature holds moral messages, but reverse the usual perspective and claim that morality consists in understanding the ways of nature and doing the opposite. Thomas Henry Huxley advanced this argument in his famous essay on Evolution and Ethics, 1893. The practice of that which is ethically best, what we call goodness or virtue, involves a course of conduct which, in all respects, is opposed to that which leads to success in the cosmic struggle for existence. In place of ruthless self-assertion, it demands self-restraint. In place of thrusting aside or treading down all competitors, it requires that the individual shall not merely respect, but shall help his fellows. It repudiates the gladiatorial theory of existence. Laws and moral precepts are directed to the end of curbing the cosmic process. The other argument, radical in Darwin's day but more familiar now, holds that nature simply is as we find it. Our failure to discern a universal good does not record any lack of insight or ingenuity, but merely demonstrates that nature contains no moral messages framed in human terms. Morality is a subject for philosophers, theologians, students of the humanities, indeed for all thinking people. The answers will not be read passively from nature. They do not, and cannot, arise from the data of science. The factual state of the world does not teach us how we, with our powers for good and evil, should alter or preserve it in the most ethical manner. Darwin himself tended toward this view, although he could not, as a man of his time, thoroughly abandon the idea that laws of nature might reflect some higher purpose. He clearly recognized the special manifestations of those laws, cats playing with mice and ichneumon larvae eating caterpillars, could not embody ethical messages, but he somehow hoped that unknown higher laws might exist with the details, whether good or bad, left to the working out of what we may call chance. Since ichneumons are a detail, and since natural selection is a law regulating details, the answer to the ancient dilemma of why such cruelty, in our terms, exists in nature can only be that there isn't any answer, and that framing the question in our terms is thoroughly inappropriate in a natural world neither made for us nor ruled by us. It just plain happens. It is a strategy that works for ichneumons and that natural selection has programmed into their behavioral repertoire. Caterpillars are not suffering to teach us something. They have simply been outmaneuvered, for now, in the evolutionary game. Perhaps they will evolve a set of adequate defenses sometime in the future, thus sealing the fate of ichneumons. And perhaps, indeed probably, they will not. Another Huxley, Thomas's grandson Julian, spoke for this position, using as an example, yes, you guessed it, the ubiquitous ichneumons. Natural selection, in fact, though like the mills of God in grinding slowly and grinding small, has few other attributes that a civilized religion would call divine. Its products are just as likely to be aesthetically, morally, or intellectually repulsive to us as they are to be attractive. We need only think of the ugliness of Saculina or a bladder worm, the stupidity of a rhinoceros or a stegosaur, the horror of a female mantis devouring its mate, or a brood of ichneumon flies slowly eating out a caterpillar. If nature is non-moral, then evolution cannot teach any ethical theory at all. The assumption that it can has abetted a panoply of social evils that ideologues falsely read into nature from their beliefs, eugenics and misnamed social Darwinism prominently among them. Not only did Darwin eschew any attempt to discover an anti-religious ethic in nature, he also expressly stated his personal bewilderment about such deep issues as the problem of evil. Just a few sentences after invoking the ichneumons, and in words that express both the modesty of this splendid man and the compatibility, through lack of contact, between science and true religion, Darwin wrote to Asa Gray, "I feel most deeply that the whole subject is too profound for the human intellect. A dog might as well speculate on the mind of Newton. Let each man hope and believe what he can." Postscript. Michelle Aldrich sent an even better literary reference than any I had found. Mark Twain, in a biting bit of satire called Little Bessie Would Assist Providence, chronicles a conversation of mother and daughter, daughter insisting that a benevolent God would not have given her little friend Billy Norris the typhus, and visiting other unjust disasters upon decent people, mother assuring her that there must be a good reason for it all. Bessie's last rejoinder, which summarily ends the essay, as you shall hear, invokes our old friends the ichneumons. Mr. Hollister says the wasps catch spiders and cram them down into their nests in the ground, alive, mama, and there they live and suffer days and days and days, and the hungry little wasps chewing their legs and gnawing into their bellies all the time to make them good and religious and praise God for his infinite mercies. I think Mr. Hollister is just lovely and ever so kind, for when I asked him if he would treat a spider like that, he said he hoped to be damned if he would. And then he... Dear Mama, have you fainted? James W. Tuttleton, chairman of the English department at New York University, sent me a stunning poem by Robert Frost that seems designed as a commentary upon Darwin's last statement that chance may regulate in the small, even if purpose might be found in the large. Or do we even see true purpose in the large? The poem is called simply Design. I found a dimpled spider, fat and white, on a white heel-all, holding up a moth, like a white piece of rigid satin cloth, assorted characters of death and blight, mixed ready to begin the morning rite, like the ingredients of a witch's broth, a snowdrop spider, a flower like a froth, and dead wings carried like a paper kite. What had that flower to do with being white, the wayside blue and innocent heel-all? What brought the kindred spider to that height, then steered the white moth thither in the night? What but design of darkness to appall, if design govern in a thing so small? I was so struck by the image of the spider as a drop, the flower as a froth, the moth as a pair of two-dimensional wings, forms so unlike, yet all white and all brought together in one spot for destruction. Why, or as we heard in the last two lines, may we even ask such a question? I think that we cannot, and I regard this insight as the most liberating theme of Darwin's revolution. 3. The Guano Ring. When I first went to sea as a petrified urbanite who had never ridden anything larger than a rowboat, an old sailor and navy man told me that I could chart my way through this aqua incognita if I remembered but one simple rule for life and work aboard a ship. If it moves, salute it. If it doesn't move, paint it. If we analyze why such a statement counts as a joke, albeit a feeble one, in our culture, we must cite the incongruity of placing such a mindless model for making decisions inside a human skull. After all, the essence of human intelligence is creative flexibility, our skill in grasping new and complex contexts, in short, our ability to make, as we call them, judgments, rather than to act by the dictates of rigid preset rules. We are, as Conrad Lawrence has stated, specialists in non-specialization. We do not behave as machines with simple yes-no switches, invariably triggered by definite bits of information present in our immediate environments. Our enlightened sailor, no matter how successful at combating rust or avoiding the brig, is not following a human style of intelligence. Yet this inflexible model does represent the style of intelligence followed with great success by most other animals. The decisions of animals are usually unambiguous yeses or noes triggered by definite signals, not subtle choices based upon the assessment of a complex gestalt. Many birds, for example, do not recognize their own young and act instead by the rule, care for what is inside the nest, ignore what is outside. British ethologist W. H. Thorpe writes, "Most birds, while they may be very attentive to their young in the nest, are completely callous and unresponsive to those same young when, as a result of some accident, they are outside the nest or the immediate nest territory." This rule rarely poses evolutionary dilemmas for birds, since the objects in their nests are usually their own young, carrying their Darwinian heritage of shared genes. But this inflexible style of intelligence can be exploited and commandeered to a nefarious purpose by other species. Cuckoos, for example, lay their eggs in the nests of other birds. A cuckoo hatchling, usually larger and more vigorous than the rightful inhabitants, often expels its legitimate nestmates, which then die, frantically begging for food, while their parents follow the rule, ignore them for their inappropriate location, and feed the young cuckoo instead. We can intellectualize our anthropomorphism away, but we cannot expunge it from our aesthetic reactions. I must confess that no scene of organic activity makes me angrier about the world's injustice than the sight of a foster parent, its own young killed by a cuckoo, solicitously feeding a begging parasite that may be up to 5 times its own size. Cuckoos often choose much smaller birds as their hosts, and the fledglings may be much larger than their foster parents. During a recent trip to the Galapagos Islands, I encountered another interestingly different example of birds that twist this common rule to different uses. This time, both the victim and benefactor are true siblings, and the end result, although condemning weaker siblings to death, is evolutionary advantage for family lines. The boobies, along with their cousins, the gannets, form a small, 9-species, but widespread family of seabirds, the Sulidae. Everything and more that you will ever want to know about sulids you will find in J. Brian Nelson's magnificent monograph, The Sulidae, Gannets and Boobies, 1978. Earliest references in the Oxford English Dictionary indicate that boobies received their unflattering name not for the distinctive waddling walk of one major display, big feet out and head held high in a behavior called sky-pointing, but for their remarkable tameness, which allowed sailors, bent only on destruction, to catch them so easily. 3 species of sulids inhabit the Galapagos Islands, the red-footed, the blue-footed, and the masked booby. The red-footed booby lays a single egg in a conventional nest built near the tops and edges of trees and bushes. By contrast, its cousin of markedly different natural pedicure, the blue-footed booby, lays its eggs on the ground and builds no true nest at all. Instead, it delimits the nesting area in a remarkable and efficient way. It squirts guano, bird shit, to non-ornithologists who have not read Dr. No, in all directions around itself, thus producing a symmetrical white ring as a symbolic marker of its nest. Within this ring, the female blue foot lays not one, as in many boobies, but from 1 to 3 eggs. In his most impressive discovery, Nelson has explained much about the breeding behavior and general ecology of boobies by linking the production of eggs and young to the quality and style of feeding in parents. Boobies that travel long distances, up to 300 miles, to locate scarce sources of food, tend to lay but a single large egg, hatching into a resilient chick that can survive long intervals between parental feedings. On the other hand, when food sources are rich, dependable, and near, more eggs are laid and more young reared. At the extreme of this tendency lies the Peruvian booby, with its clutch of 2 to 4 eggs, averaging 3, and its ability to raise all chicks to adulthood. Peruvian boobies feed on the teeming anchovies of their local waters, fish that may be almost as densely packed in the ocean as in the sardine cans that may become their posthumous home. The bluefoot lies between these two tendencies. It is a near-shore feeder, but its sources have neither the richness nor the predictability of swarming anchovies. Consequently, conditions vary drastically from generation to generation. The bluefoot has therefore evolved a flexible strategy based on the exploitation by older siblings of their parents' intellectual style. Yes-no decisions triggered by simple signals. In good times, parents may lay up to 3 eggs and successfully fledge all 3 chicks. In poor years, they may still lay 2 or 3 eggs and hatch all their chicks, but only 1 can survive. The death of nest, or rather ring mates, is not the haphazard result of a losing struggle to feed all chicks with insufficient food, but a highly systematic affair based on indirect murder by the oldest sibling. I was reminded of the quip about painting and saluting while observing blue-footed boobies on Hood Island in the Galapagos. Their guano rings cover the volcanic surface in many places, often blocking the narrow paths that visitors must tread in these well-protected islands. Parents sit on their eggs and young chicks, apparently oblivious to groups of visitors who gawk, gesticulate, and point cameras within inches of their territory. Yet I noticed, at first by accident, that any intrusion into a guano ring would alter the behavior of adult birds from blissful ignorance to directed aggression. A single toe across the ring elicited an immediate barrage of squawking, posturing, and pecking. A few casual experiments led me to the tentative conclusion that the boundary is an invisible circle right in the middle of the ring. I could cautiously advance my toe across the outer part of the ring with no effect. But as I moved it forward, as slowly and as unobtrusively as possible, I invariably passed a central point that brought on the pronounced parental reaction all at once.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.